say all the things that I should say. Say them loud, say them clear, for the whole round world to hear.
In the summer of 1909, a full decade before women were granted the right to vote, a remarkable series of meetings were held on the grounds of an old marble mansion in the Inwood section of northern Manhattan. Over the course of that summer, the old Seaman mansion, a surviving holdout from the region's quickly fading Gilded Age, played host to early members of the suffragist movement. As attendees stepped onto the elevated platform of the newly constructed West 215th Street station and descended the staircase to 10th Avenue, the mood was excited. Throughout the afternoon, they arrived by subway, trolley, and some likely in horse and carriage, to discuss a then radical concept, a woman's right to vote. That summer, more than a century ago, members of the Equality League for Self-Supporting Women held three conferences. Members called them outings. According to instructions, printed on a postal mailing, the attendees met up at the Marble Arch, a once familiar landmark that served as the entrance to the former estate of John Seaman and Anne Drake. The gatherings were attended by some of the greatest minds of the women's equality movement and were held in a garden with stunning views of both the Harlem and Hudson Rivers. Speakers included Mrs. Frederick Nathan, better known as Maud. The silver-haired New Yorker, then in her early 50s, came from a prominent Sephardic Jewish family and had married her first cousin, Frederick Nathan, at the age of 17. Maud was known to stuff cash into bundles of suffrage flyers in the hopes of gaining converts in search of prizes possibly contained within the movement's literature. Elizabeth Ellsworth Cook, the so-called champion girl debater from Cornell University, spoke as well. A noted pacifist, suffragist, and later successful businessperson, Ellsworth was 26 when she addressed her compatriots. Another notable attendee was Leonora O'Reilly, a trade union organizer and daughter of poor Irish immigrants who had come to New York to escape the potato famine in their homeland. Leonora, a single woman, adopted a child in 1907. The little girl, Alice, died in 1911. Also on hand was Josephine Casey, who, like O'Reilly, was the daughter of Irish immigrants. Casey, a noted labor leader, helped organize the International Ladies' Garment Workers Union. The gatherings began at 3 in the afternoon, when the midday heat had waned. Each speaker was allotted no more than 15 minutes. Free lemonade and literature was provided to all. According to a printed announcement, although these Votes for Women outings, as they have been officially named, are designed chiefly for women wage earners who cannot conveniently go to meetings on the other 6 days of the week, all persons of either sex who believe that women should have the ballot, or who are on the verge of conversion, or who are sure that they will never be converted, will be welcomed. Those in attendance witnessed the dawn of a new era. The 19th Amendment, still a decade away, might never have been ratified had that core group of radical minds not gathered on an Inwood hilltop more than a century ago. I wish I could do-